The Checkpoint is presented by GM Pharma, the first international multinational pharmaceutical company in Georgia. GM Pharma, to serve those who need it most.
This week, Georgia lost a promising young man, a true future leader, young entrepreneur, Nicholas Kvaratskhelia. Nico was tragically shot 8 times in the center of Tbilisi in the middle of the day due to life-threatening wounds and despite countless efforts, the doctors could not save him. Our viewers and followers know Nicholas Kvaratskhelia for his important contributions to the Georgian business, especially for creating his first already successful company, FITS. FITS is the first Georgian social media platform, already has more than 250,000 active users and keeps ranking as one of the most used apps in the country. All the achievements of the company are forever connected to Nico's name. Nico was a part of BMG and Forbes big family. He was one of the youngest Forbes 30 under 30s we have ever had. At such a young age, Nicholas still managed to leave his astonishing mark on the Georgian business community and society. We want to pay our deepest respects to his family and loved ones. Georgia lost an exceptionally bright young man, a shining star of the future, whose name and dedicated work will forever be marked in our minds and hearts.
Listening to you, Georgi, and mourning this young man on Forbes Georgia list 30 under 30, this is such a tragedy for the small country that has limited chances to expand globally. And Niko Kvaratskhelia was the one who had both the motivation and the capacity to check in Georgia on the world map. This death of a young entrepreneur, a young employer, is also very unfortunate for this country. Since if we look at the current statistics of Georgia, we will see that the unemployment mainly targets those aged 20 to 40, the ones who are the most productive, the most open to new experiences and knowledge, those who have the most potential to create a well-functioning middle class in this country. I surely hope that all involved in this brutal murder will be identified and sentenced. Silence and inaction will bury this country deep into the hole of the dark 90s, the devastating results of which we have already experienced in the history of this country and in the era of such technological achievements and breakthroughs as that of Niko Kvaratskhelia as well. There will no longer be a chance for Georgia to be on even terms with the rest of the world. So instead of 1 minute silence, I suggest all of us watch our old video that you just mentioned, Niko Kvaratskhelia with his big plans on the 30 under 30.
FITS is a location-based media platform which lets people understand what's happening where they are right now. Currently, FITS is presented in a couple of countries, which are Georgia, Ukraine, Armenia, and Azerbaijan. We identified that there are 5 types of happening now content. And these 5 types of content are basically TV and live streams. And that's why all the major TV channels that are in Georgia are presented on FITSI. The second type of happening now content is articles. What we did at FITSI is that we brought all the major news outlets and all the major blogs in the countries in which we operate to one platform, to one place, and they're presented based on locations. A third type of happening now content which we found was content made by people. we created a very comfortable posting experience so that people can share this type of content very easily. The fourth type of content is photo content, which is pictures that people take during the day. They might see something that's happening outside, they take a picture, they upload it directly to Fitzy. And the last one is video. The number of users is growing rapidly around the world, especially in the countries in which we're actively investing and actively working on growth. These are Armenia, Ukraine, Georgia, and Azerbaijan. In these countries, we have more than 700,000 monthly active users in total, and this number is growing very rapidly. And what has caused this growth is our continuous innovation and improvement of the product. So since launch, we've weekly delivered updates to our product, which are I'm not talking about minor improvements or minor changes. We are delivering major improvements and major changes, which are making our product more accessible to different types of users, and which are making our product more interesting for different types of users. Besides this, we're actively investing in personalization, in AI, which is basically improving our product the longer you use it and the more you use it. Right now, our main target is to become one of the number one sources of happening now content and number one source of understanding what's happening wherever you are right now. Currently, our main partner is CBS Group. CBS Group is one of the largest investment firms in Georgia. Our short-term goal is to become a number one source of local information in the countries in which we operate right now, which I mentioned earlier. And our long-term goal is to become number one source of one of the main sources of local information around the world.
You're watching The Checkpoint. Zelena Kvantilashvili and myself, David Jalagonia, will be hosting it. Thank you, Georgi, for your contribution, and we will be having more from you to share in this program.
Yes, 10 p.m. sharp, and we are on air, and here are the headlines.
The Soviet chess pioneer Nona Gaprindashvili sued Netflix on Thursday for defamation, seeking $5 million in damages over a false statement about her in the fictional series The Queen's Gambit.
The final episode of The Queen's Gambit includes a line from an announcer who describes Gaprindashvili as the female world champion and has never faced men.
The lawsuit obtained by Deadline says the dialogue is false and sexist and belittling because Gaprindashvili beat some of the best male chess players in the world and was the first woman to achieve the status of international chess grandmaster.
The lawsuit claims Netflix was aware of this information but deliberately lied about her achievements for the cheap and cynical purpose of making the show's fictional protagonist, Beth Harmon, played by actress Anya Taylor-Joy, appear groundbreaking.
Netflix said in a statement to Forbes the company has the utmost respect for Mrs. Gaprindashvili and her illustrious career. However, they believe this claim has no merit and they will vigorously defend the case.
BMG was the only business media and the first media in Georgia to be exclusively informed about the details of the lawsuit after the U.S. I'm really proud to say that BMG's analytics hosted Rusudan Maysuradze, a BLB partner and advocate of Nona Gaprindashvili, on Friday. Today in the Checkpoints, we will give you the full profile of her in the new rubric by our reporter Nini Longurashvili, the professional. This rubric will focus its interest on the people who know how to do their job excellently.
This is how I start. I wake up in the morning full of energy and have a look at the city. I know it's waiting for me with a lot of work to do. Good morning.
How are you?
Fine, and you?
Well, what's the story here this morning?
Are you ready for the meetings?
Yes, but what are you doing?
I will leave soon. I will finish the coffee and go.
Is this an interview?
Yes, we're recording an interview here. This is how he's been since COVID started. He wears formal t-shirts and shorts. This is how he attends Zoom meetings.
Not always.
True. Not always. People should always strive for development. This is how I live and this is how I raise my children. Freezing in one place kills everything. I myself was born into a socially vulnerable family and knew that I had to achieve everything on my own. This was in the 90s when nothing good was happening around. In any profession, you need a lot of work. If you're not familiar not only with Georgian court practice, but also with international practices, it will be very difficult for you to become a high-level professional. Personally, I get acquainted with international practices all the time. I've been doing this since I was 16 years old. When I entered the Faculty of Law, I didn't become a lawyer because of the high salary promise. A lot of people have this approach, and it's wrong, even though good lawyers do have high incomes, even in a country like Georgia. This approach never brings any results. You cannot think like that. First of all, you have to love what you do. If you do not love what you do, you will never get to the point where your job brings high income. The fact that Rusudan Maysuradze is a good professional today did not come by itself. This has not been an easy path. It has not been easy for me to come so far, to be a partner of one of the most successful law firms. It was not easy to find a job. It was impossible to find a job. For a year, I was completely depressed without a job. Even today, I do not know which kind-hearted person is responsible for accepting me into the Bar Association. One day, I got a phone call and was told I had been accepted into a Bar Association. That was my first and very small but very important step. Then I got a job at TBC Bank. When I became a senior lawyer, I realized I was kind of stuck professionally. I decided to go to the United States and continue my studies. Back then, there was this program called MUSC program. I trained myself for it. I trained myself in English. I had to pass the TOEFL exam. Basically, I won my place in the program. But it happened so that I started a family, and my husband, who is the CEO of TBC Bank, fired me the next day. Obviously, he said that we couldn't work together. After that, I started working in a private law firm. Back then, there was a large company called GRDC. It was a very large company with 24 companies under its wing. I was in charge of the legal activities of these 24 companies. GRDC has helped me gain extensive experience in business law. I wanted to continue to advance professionally, so I went to study in London. Today, I am where I am, a partner of one of the most successful Georgian law firms, and I'm happy to say that I am a partner alongside very good professionals and very good people.
On the other hand, in order to gain huge economic benefits and position itself on the world market, film tourism in Georgia is becoming increasingly popular, in demand and relevant. There was a Georgian-Ukrainian project, Indian serials were also shot, but the premiere of Fast and Furious 9 still raised special expectations because next to Tokyo, London, next to Cologne, Georgia is also represented in the film with dignity. The premiere was about 3 months ago, and we wonder what the results were of participating in a blockbuster German film that is actually watched by everyone all over the world. Mariam Adamia reports.
Uniting cinema and tourism can become a guarantee of success for the country. This is evidenced by many examples, including the filming and premiere of The Lord of the Rings and The Hobbit, which resulted in the creation of tourist routes in New Zealand, where The Hobbiton was visited by an average of 300 tourists a day. Revenues from tourism in the country increased from $6 to $9 billion. Even more, large-scale and impressive numbers can be demonstrated if we recall the Game of Thrones, which increased the inflow of tourists in Croatia by 150%.
There's no need for a battle.
Encouraged by successful examples, countries have gradually started cooperating with the film industry to produce tourism films.
James Bond.
Georgia also tested its fate in this regard. Universal Studios showed interest in our country and shot several scenes of the Fast and Furious 9 movie in various cities as well as in the capital of Georgia. Seeing Georgia next to Tokyo, London, and Cologne is a wonderful sight. Along with beautiful visuals, there was also an economic effect. However, what impact the film had on the interest of tourists, what be expected, or what results we got wasn't really assessed by anyone. We asked the program manager of Film in Georgia some questions.
After Fast and Furious 9 was shot in Georgia, it became really easier for us to present ourselves properly in international market, and now they are okay, all of the top productions, to come and negotiate with that, and they have like proof that we really did it in a proper way, so the Georgia is now on the map of the international film market. It's been several months that everything started to move on, and the government of Georgia renewed and redesigned Film in Georgia cash rebate program, which is now shaped in very attractive terms and cures, and now our production and post-production companies are very, really active, and they have negotiations with international production companies.
At this time, more than 100 million of the world's population have seen Fast and Furious 9, which means that at least as many people should have received information about the existence of Georgia. We cannot attribute the merits of the film views to Georgian scenes, but Fast and Furious is a pandemic record holder. It showed the best results in terms of views and income. According to Keti Bojorishvili, the former Deputy Minister of Economy, more results will be seen after the end of the pandemic, because the interest and awareness has increased even more after the release of the film, especially in the United States.
Actually, Fast and Furious 9 was among the top films who had the record number of the people watching this movie, and as well as the revenues. Unfortunately, still we don't see the direct impact from this film because of the COVID regulations and worldwide the decrease of the tourist numbers. But I'm sure there is a lot of curiosity, a lot of interest in specific groups where it was harder to reach them, especially Western European countries, especially United States. So I'm sure this film has increased the interest among foreigners, and as soon as pandemic is over and the traveling regulations are easier in the world, we will see bigger numbers of tourists coming to Georgia.
More than 1,000 people were employed, and 40 million lari was spent on the filming of Fast and Furious 9 in Georgia, which was redistributed to salaries, accommodation, food, logistics, props, and etc. It had a diverse economic impact. In addition, nearly 1,000 people were trained who have gained extensive experience working on such a film. As for the tourism part, after the premiere of the film, the pandemic has unfortunately temporarily paused the long-awaited tourism boom. What will be the next step? We will ask this step by step, along with providing you with the updated statistics.
Let us then proceed with the interview with Mikhail Hidureli, CEO of Enterprise Georgia, whom, by the way, Mariam's story also featured. Our reporter, Georgi Sakadze, talked to Mikhail Hidureli and will now update us on the Enterprise Georgia's current projects and more.
Misha, thank you so much for your time. You're just always confirming your readiness to deliver some news and updates from your agency, and thank you for being with us on the checkpoints.
Thank you, Georgi. Always welcome.
There's some news. I've been moved from the presenter of the checkpoints to a reporter. So nowadays I'm representing the team, and so much happy to update our viewers and followers regarding some news about the program newly established components, which has been announced by Prime Minister, by the Minister of Economic Development. Could you be so kind to details, some precising news in regards of this?
Okay, yes, you know that we had many programs, mainly directed for SME development. Most of them are access to finance programs. 90% of them are in the collaboration with the bank. So the entrepreneur goes to the bank, gets the loan, and then we subsidize the interest rate on one side. And then also we provided collateral guarantees. That was called our industrial program, and also hosting Georgia for the talk. What we did right now is some kind of combination of these two, and plus we added a grant component. So we created two main programs. One of them is called Business Universal. It's called Universal because it is universal. It covers more than 300 business varieties. So almost any type of business is being funded by this program, with a very few exemptions like mining, energy, retail, transport, and I think that's it. A part of this, all others are being financed, and the concept of the program is very simple. You get the interest rate subsidy, not for 3 years like it used to be before, but now for the whole duration and the full duration of the loan. So if you get a loan for 10 years, you are covered by Enterprise Georgia for 10 years. But the percentage of the interest rate has decreased, logically. If it was, for example, 12%, now it will be 5%. So every year you're going to get 5% less interest rate than you would get without having enrolled in our program. At the same time, you get 60% collateral on the whole amount of the loan. So you got two things at the same time. You get the interest rate for the full duration of the loan, and plus you get collateral, 60% collateral. This is called Business Universal. Another program, which is a priority program, it's called Business Export, which covers a type of businesses that are type of sectors that are export oriented, or they decrease reliance on the import. So it's limited number of business varieties. Not all sectors are covered here. And the concept is very similar to Business Universal. Again, you get interest rate for 10 years subsidy, and then you get collateral guarantee. And plus, in addition, you get 15% grant. 15% grant out of the whole amount of the loan. So let's put in a, let's describe it according to case, right? So you get, for example, you go to the bank, you want to, I don't know, manufacture furniture. You get the loan, 1 million Georgian lari. Out of that, 60%, which means 600,000 Georgian lari, is provided by the government as a collateral. You get the loan subsidy for 10 years, and plus you get 15% as a, let's call it a cashback or a grant. 15% grant, which means that 150,000 Georgian lari is the money you get from Enterprise Georgia, and this is the money you can, you know, use in accordance to your needs for the business. So you can spend it for, I don't know, raw material, you can spend it for capital expenditure, whatever you want. So you get three things: subsidy, guarantee, and the grant. In addition to this, we created a special program for agro and ecotourism. Again, this is one of the first cases where we created a special program for these two directions. Again, the rules are the same as in business export. You get the subsidy, you get the guarantee, and you get the 15% grant. I think we will see very positive growth in eco and agrotourism, especially in the regions, because now entrepreneurs can use not only one program, but three programs at the same time. So this is in a nutshell the new concept of the programs, which is kind of revision of the old, with one addition that we added a grants component. We never had a grants component alongside with our loan program.
Can we say and suggest that grant component in this field is exploring and progressing so much that it's more most like loan oriented I mean, your agency's direction, and now grant component is getting so much active. And do you conform at the head of the agencies that you are working on various directions, and grant component in your relations with Georgian entrepreneurship will be even more broadened?
This is a good question, because yeah, you noticed it in a very right manner. This is the first time when we are supporting companies in their equity, because in a way, essentially, the grant, 15% grant, is an equity, right? We come in an equity. So all the programs we had was loan, subsidy, interest rate, collateral, and now, yes, this 15% grant is an equity component, which we
yeah, actually, you were right. When it doesn't matter, you call it cashback, as it is done by some IFIs and things like that. It's a grant, and yeah. Entrepreneur can use it up to his mind, whatever he wants.
Yeah. Without having to return it. So it's kind of a unique type of equity, which you don't have to, have a share there, or we don't ask to get this money back. This is a grant company. But in a way, it looks like an equity. And what is the most important thing here, right? So you get the collateral, you get the subsidy, you get the equity. So all the access to finance components are there in place. So it makes really easy for an entrepreneur and for the bank to fund the finance the project, which means that it's going to open doors for new type of segments and new type of entrepreneurs.
Got you. Misha, expanding the period for all the loan period, as you mentioned, you think that it's going to be confirmed further for the next year, and up to those, or it's just for this period, let me call it still post-pandemic, or what the reason of this decision, why you decided to do so?
Yeah, I think in a way this new concept has a macroeconomic concept in its
impact, you mean?
Macroeconomic component, because you know at the end of the day,
maybe you mean impact. That's what I mean.
It will impact. I mean, it will decrease the credit burden, right? Because it's not for 3 years; it's for the whole duration of the. Which means that it will decrease for the entrepreneurs and for a big, choice of sectors. It will decrease the interest rate in total. So I think, yes, I don't think it's only post-pandemic. Probably this will be some kind of new concept that we are now experimenting, because we have to see, right? We have to see how it works. But I think that if you are an entrepreneur and if you count having 12% for 3 years, but comparing this to having 5% but for 10 years, you know, it might be interesting to think about maybe for 10 years it's better, because at the end of the day you get the same benefit. But what is most important is that you decrease the credit burden, not for 3 years, but for the full duration of the business.
Together with your team, while being a part of this agency, if I'm not mistaken, last 4 years, you've been analyzing at the same time with the partner companies, audit companies as well. You've been analyzing figures and statistics of the impact, while we mentioned it, not to the macroeconomic. I'm talking about the agency producing Georgia itself. So far, do you have any update information what the impact the Georgian economy of the investing amounts going to the Georgian companies from your agency? What do we have so far now, please?
Right now, what we have, Georgi, is that we know that one lari that is subsidized by the government has stimulated 16 lari from the entrepreneur side, which means that you give them one lari subsidy and then they attract 16 lari. Either from the donor, either from their own equity, which means that one lari is generating 16 times more investment from their side. This is the
I'm sorry, which includes also taxes, or it's another part of the story?
No, the taxi is another part of the story. One lari generates 5 lari taxes for the country. So every
and
lari
it's separate.
Yes, is the 16, when I say 16 times, it's an investment. It's only counted. It's only investment. and it generates five times more than the taxes. But okay, to be frank, this is the statistics that are 2 years old. You know that we did study with BDO, but I have a good news. You know that we have 1 year and a half ago, we created an analysis and monitoring department with a very, very high capacity of human capital. And with alongside and with a great support of GIZ, we created a framework of impact assessments, which means that very soon, probably for the 22, by the end of this year and also the next year,
beginning of 2022,
we're going to have our own team who will conduct, who is now already conducting an impact assessment for another bunch of 100 enterprises, right? 100 companies, 100 hotels, factories. And this is great because we're going to be doing it constantly, which means that we will have our mind already set on the dynamics of what is happening. So very soon, we're going to have some initial findings of the impact assessment of another companies.
Relevant data analysis of the impact,
Not outsourced, insourced, and that is very important.
Insourced team, okay. And my final question about FDI, you are aware about the last statistics in regards of remittances, which are growing stable, but at the same time, FDI still causes some headaches in these fields for us. It's been the same problematic directions before pandemic as well. What do we have so far? And is there anything what we can present to the rest of the world as organic, as different, which will create more attractiveness to us?
Okay, yeah, one of the things that we created is, you know, the, it's called FDI grant. People are asking why we don't have any beneficiaries there. It's, I mean, again, it's really, really easy to criticize, but you know, FDI, when you especially talk about the new program, the program itself will not attract investments only. The program is an auxiliary additional, let's say, advantage of the country. Right now we have, projects in FDI grant program that are in the pipeline. Some of them are very, very, let's say, close to the closure. Mainly these are logistics. You know that we are very actively working on BPO sector. And next week, probably we're going to have a very good news for the public regarding FDIs in general. And I don't want to say the details now, but it will be a very positive one of the, let's say, for the latest period, one of the, let's say, most important news for FDI for one of the sectors in Georgia. So
till the next week, then, Misha.
Yes.
See you. Bye. Thank you so much.
After mentioning the emerging opportunities for Georgia in film tourism, let us focus on a more established market and his. Our outlook for the wine industry in Georgia, numbers, volumes, markets, Lika Gurabanidze and Anita Wadze report.
More than 8,000 years and more than 500 varieties of wines. This is the history of Georgian winemaking. In 2020, more than 280,000 tons of grapes were processed in Georgia, which is quite a large number considering the small local market of the country. Consequently, Georgia's wine and spirits sector is heavily dependent on foreign markets and receives about 85% of its revenues from exports. We are far behind the top wine-producing countries, says a study by Galton Taggart. The study notes that the competition in the wine production market is great, and Georgia ranks 19th in this market. It takes extra effort to compete with these top producing countries. We need huge marketing costs. We need to take extra shelves in retail chains, which also involves large sums of money. Despite entering new export markets, dependence on Russia and post-Soviet countries remains a challenge for the local market. The share of new export markets is growing. The total share of the US, the UK, China, Japan, Germany, Poland, and the Baltic states in wine and spirits exports rose from about 11% in 2013 to 21.5% in the first half of 2021. However, the share of the Russian Federation itself remains high, and it accounts for 58% of total exports. The Galton Taggart study also notes that the high share of exports to the Russian Federation is due to the popularity of Georgian wine in Russia and trade relations with Russia.
Сегодняшнее предложение Госдумы запретить импорт, например, грузинского вина.
However, given the painful consequences of the 2006 Russian embargo and the general unpredictability of this market, export diversification should remain a top priority for Georgian wine companies in the medium to long term. When the sector is dependent on export markets, it is important that these markets be as diversified as possible. It is never a profitable strategy in the long run to be dependent on one particular country. Although in recent years the wine agency has been quite active in trying to diversify its markets and enter new export markets, be it the US or the UK, Poland, the Baltics, Germany, and so on, nevertheless, Russia is our leading export market. Despite the difficulties in export markets, the wine and spirits sector is one of the most profitable in Georgia. In 2019, the overall profit margin of the sector was 30.2%, while the operating profit margin was 20.8%, which is 1.4 times and 1.7 times higher than the average of the business sector. Despite the pandemic, revenues in the wine and spirits sector fell by only 2.1% in 2020, which was due to stable foreign demand. In 2020, wine exports fell by 5.6% to 210.3 million. This decrease is much lower compared to 2015 crisis when exports almost halved. The National Wine Agency notes that a lot of depends on the quality of Georgian wine, and winemakers should take care of it. The chairman of the agency believes that being in the 19th place in export markets for Georgia is not bad, because Georgia produces small amounts.
There are countries in the top 10 that have such a large-scale economy compared to us that competing with them in terms of quantity is wrong. However, at the expense of increasing the quality and removing the post-pandemic effects, I think it is necessary to increase the average price of Georgian wine and a steady increase in the income that wine brings to the country.
As for the Russian and CIS markets, the representatives of the wine-producing companies explained that the dependence on the Russian and CIS markets is due to the high awareness of Georgian wine there. Businesses pointed out that they are constantly diversifying markets.
The markets of the CIS countries are important for us, as Georgian wine has a long tradition in terms of recognition. This is also important in terms of advertising, as many tourists visit these countries. We do diversification in our own in different markets. The second most important market for us is the European market. We have our logistics base in Germany, from where our products are redistributed to all countries in Europe. We systematically export Georgian wine to about 30 countries. We have 2, 3, and sometimes 4 partners in important markets in the same country, which allows us to be more widely represented. Diversification is an annual task, both to develop existing markets, to add new ones. As for the Russian market, which is one of the most desirable and important markets, not only for Georgian wine, but also for the world economy, we are represented there, but we try not to have more than 30% of our sales in Russia. Our dependence on Russia is not high.
Companies have already started the active processing of grapes. They are satisfied with the quality and therefore their plans are big. They believe that the sector is not in a bad situation, but it does take some time to move forward.
We're not a country producing cheap wine. We need more marketing actions, which is certainly what the state work on better. There are some areas in which we have different opinions. Overall, the situation is satisfactory. Of course, it would be good if the state listened more to the producers and industry in general. There are types of wines that make us different. This is Pitcher Natural wines, which occupy a place in the high price segment. They are mainly targeted at the European and American markets. With such wines, we should create the image of high-quality wine-producing country.
The harvest is in an active phase in Kakheti. Almost 45% of the yield has already been processed. The daily processing of grapes is within 10,000 tons, which indicates the active process of harvesting. In Kakheti, viticulturists have already earned more than 120 million lari from the sale of grapes.
Tatya Mamrikishvili from Galten Taggart will further analyze Georgia's wine market and perspectives following a very thorough report on this sector that was published last week.
Can we say that this market in Georgia has shown resilience during the pandemic period?
You know that 2020 was quite a tough year for Georgian economy as for the rest of the world. Like the economy contracted by 6.2% and most of the sectors have recorded severe losses. However, the Georgia's wine and spirits sector showed resilience to COVID-19 and the turnover of the sector was only down by 2.1%. That was actually mainly due to the stable exports from of wine and spirits from Georgia. As for the local market, pandemic affected the market negatively, like the turnover generated from the local market almost halved in 2020. That was due to the halt in tourism, you know, that the cafes, restaurants, bars, etc. were closed in this year, and this resulted into the contraction of the local market. However, the local market actually accounts for low share in total turnover of this sector, so this did not have the effect on the stability of the sector in 2020.
So, Tatya, based on a very thorough and very interesting report that Galten Taggart had on this sector, on Georgia's wine sector, what would you identify as main figures that that show the trend of development of this sector in Georgia?
85% of the revenue stream comes from the export markets. And in recent years, you know that most of the exports are going to Russia, and we are still dependent on Russia and post-Soviet countries. However, our National Wine Agency of Georgia is trying to increase the popularity of Georgian wine and target a new target export markets like say Baltic states, Poland, Japan, China, and etc. So the exports are increasing in these countries, and this also helps to the sector stability.
Yes, 58% was my main figure as well, Tatya, and that's the dependency on Russian market. Definitely. Can we explain a little bit and elaborate a little bit on why that creates problems and challenges for the sustainability and for the profitability in the long run?
Yeah, sure. For the sector that is dependent on the exports, this is not beneficial to be dependent on a single country. In this case, to Russia. And considering the negative effects of 2006 years embargo that Russia imposed to us, and considering the general unpredictability related to this country, we believe that diversification will be quite beneficial for the long-term development of the sector. Besides, Russia is our largest export market. However, it is the cheapest. We have identified like four types of Georgian wine that is exported from Georgia: Safaravia, Lozani, Velikint, Maraulian, etc. And these four types of wines account for 75% of Georgian exports. And Russia is the cheapest country for all these varieties. Average price of these varieties is almost two times lower in Russia than, for example, in USA, and 1.3 times lower than in China. So Russia on one hand is our largest export market, but it is the cheapest.
Sorry for interrupting, but probably quality has to also play some role in this, right?
Yeah, sure. Not only the quality, but we have actually interviewed some of the top players in this sector to identify the main reasons why we are still dependent on Russia and why we cannot get shares in new target export markets. And the one thing is that Russian customers know Georgian wine quite well. They love Georgian wine. They know Georgian need some marketing expenses to popularize Georgian wine in Russian market. Besides, they know Georgian quality and they like the quality of Georgian wine, and this is also beneficial. But but as I have already mentioned, this is the cheapest country for us, so we have to work on the quality of wine, and we have to increase our marketing expenses to new target export markets to increase our exports to this country.
If we look at this market overall, on the one hand, it is the market that is quite profitable, probably the most profitable in Georgia, but on the other hand, it is still in one way or another is dependent on subsidies. How do you explain this?
Actually, this sector is one of the most profitable sectors. The gross profit margin of the sector stands at 30%. That is 1.4 times higher than the average of the business sector in Georgia. And operating profit margin also stands at 20%. That is also higher than the average of the business sector. So this is the profitable sector. However, we have analyzed the trends in last 10 years, and the profitability is reducing in recent years. And the main reason of this is that the sector is supported by the government through different kinds of subsidies and purchases of excess production from the market. And this incentivizes many small companies to enter to the market. And these companies are usually small and inefficient, and they are dragging down the overall profitability of the sector, because we have also analyzed the profitability metrics of top 10 companies in the sectors, and we have seen the average weighted average EBITDA and gross profit margins of these top companies, and they are stable while the average profitability of the sector is on the downward trajectory.
Also, Georgia's wine making has the story, right? The marketing story. 8,000 years is a very good starting point. Probably you would agree. But still, in this case, we also see problems, and we see that government and taxpayers money is being involved in this direction as well. What is Katrin Taggart's take on this? What should be the government's role in promoting Georgian wine?
You know, on one hand, as I have already mentioned, as government subsidizes the sector, many people like this, this results sometimes into the low quality of the grapes. You know, that's the major part of the vineyards in Georgia are owned by households. And as they know that if their quality of the grapes will not meet the standards, they can still sell these grapes, so they do not have the incentive to improve the quality of their grapes, and this results into the low quality of our grapes and low productivity per hectare. Grape yield per hectare in Georgia is like two times lower than the world average, and this is also the problem in the sector. So on another hand, government has initiated the program to co-finance the marketing expenses to some companies that are trying to increase their exports to new target export markets, excluding Russia and CIC. And we believe that this is a quite good initiation to support these companies, because the companies themselves are fearing to lose their investments, and many of them are this fact deters many of the companies to enter new markets. And we believe that this kind of support from the government will be more beneficial for the sector in the long-term development, because this will lead to greater exports to new markets and reduce our dependability on Russia. And this will also increase our popularity in Georgian wine popularity in more expensive and non-traditional markets.
And my last question, and to sum up and to round up our conversation, what are like top priority recommendations from Galten Taggart to this sector?
We think that the top priority for the sector should be the reorientation from Russia. As I have already mentioned, this market is like unpredictable. And if you also remember the 2006 embargo, we should try to increase the share of new target markets, that, as I have already mentioned, in our exports. And also we should try to improve our grape quality as well as the wine quality in order to have the potential to compete with those top producing wine and world's top wine producers like Spain, Italy, France, Chile, Australia, etc., who we compete with in new target export markets.
And some good news on the business climate in Georgia. Fraser Institute named Georgia among top 5 countries in the world with the highest economic freedom. Today we will present a debut. Our senior reporter for the BM.G, our English language agency, will try her luck in video storytelling for the checkpoints. Natia Taktakishvili reports.
Georgia ranks on the 5th place according to the economic freedom of the world. Fraser Institute published annual report on economic freedom of the world 2021. As of the report, Georgia's position has improved by 3 places compared to the previous year, and it ranks on the 5th place in the global ranking. The score given to the country is determined by 8.26 out of 10 points. In the 2020 report, Georgia was on the 8th place with 8.24 points. Here is the rating of top 5 countries, which includes Hong Kong, Singapore, New Zealand, Switzerland, Georgia. Fraser Institute evaluates the countries according to the 5 main criteria: size of government, legal system and property rights, sound money, freedom to the trade internationally, and regulations. Namely, Georgia has a better evaluation in the following indicators: size of government, legal system and property rights, freedom to the trade internationally. However, the report does not explain the reasons what reforms have led to this improvement. EPRC's deputy director Irina Goruli declares that the investors always took at the researches, but the international ratings don't give full picture of the reality on the ground.
You know, there are several directions and several type of research that investors do prior to investing in a country. And one of them is the international ratings that they usually look at, because they're good sources of information to understand what's the reality on the ground. However, they usually complement this information with other type of information search, such as looking at personal networks, talking to other investors, etc. For this purpose, international rankings do not give a full picture of...
As Irina Goruli declares, the foreign direct investments hit record low in 2021, and the pandemic is one of the reasons which lays behind it.
There are different type of reasons behind it. Pandemic could be one of them, but as I have mentioned, the decrease has started already in the in the pre-pandemic period. So that's why the reasons lie behind some other type of data, such as this could be mistrust among investors due to several notorious cases. One of them is Anaklia Black Sea port, other type of perceptions that investors have in Georgia, such as lack of rule of law, independent judiciary, and backsliding of democracy.
According to Georgi Papava, lead economist at ISET Policy Institute, particular evidences show that international ratings and foreign direct investments are positively correlated with each other.
Empirical evidence shows that economic freedom and foreign direct investments, inflow of the foreign direct investments, are positively correlated with each other. And we see that countries with higher economic freedom usually host a larger share of FDI investments. At the same time, indices and rankings are not the only determinant of countries' attractiveness. And sometimes we have to go beyond the beyond rankings and look at the particular situation in the country.
This is one of the rankings, Elena, and where Georgia ranks pretty decent over the years, and this is important since investors, especially those who hear of Georgia for the first time, are interested in these rankings as usual. Another ranking where Georgia has high position is Easy of Doing Business Index, and probably you have heard of the recent scandal around World Bank's very famous ranking.
Indeed, David, it was surprising to read that the International Monetary Fund Managing Director Kristalina Georgieva was called out by the World Bank itself, her previous employer, for applying pressure to boost China's position in a ranking of economies. From what I have read, Georgieva said she disagreed with the findings compiled by an outside law firm at the World Bank's direction. However, the World Bank seems to find such serious ethics issues in its probe of the business report, and it has decided to cancel the series entirely, a statement released in Washington showed. But on the other hand, both of us know that the IMF and World Bank, David, have confronted a number of ethics issues over the years.
Yes, Elena, we have read numbers of articles on, for example, former French Foreign Minister Dominique Strauss-Kahn resigned as head of the fund in 2011 after charges of sexual assault in New York hotel room, which were eventually dropped. In 2007, Paul Wolfowitz, a top Pentagon official in the Bush administration, stepped down as a head of the World Bank over his involvement in arranging a pay increase and promotion for this campaign.
And Christine Lagarde as well, while leading the IMF, was convicted of negligence in 2016 by a Paris court over her handling of a multi-million euro dispute during her times as France's finance minister nearly a decade before. She didn't face a fine or prison term and went on to become the head of the European Central Bank. As for Kristalina Georgieva, this is what she said in a statement: "I disagree fundamentally with the findings and interpretations of the investigation of data irregularities as it relates to my role in the World Bank's Doing Business Report of 2018. I have already had an initial briefing with the IMF's executive board on this matter." Georgieva is also expected to address the World Bank report at an all-staff meeting of the IMF.
Elena, I think it's the right time to present our next report, because we know that different international funds were interested in a gas storage project, and it got a loan from German state-owned investment and development bank, but the government spent this money on relieving COVID results. What are the upcoming plans? It was the main question for us while working on this project. Let's take a look. It's been 5 years since the Georgian Oil and Gas Corporation announced their plans about construction of gas storage in Georgia. If in the very first years we heard that the main obstacles were procurement procedures, nowadays there's COVID-19 against this strategic project. The Georgian government spent 120 million euro on anti-pandemic goals, but initially this money was assigned for the gas storage project by the German state-owned investment and development bank. So now this project is left without money. The checkpoint sent questions to the Georgian Oil and Gas Corporation to figure out the government's plans connected with the gas storage project. As one of the officials, Temur Gochitashvili, says, there's no upcoming plan how the corporation is going to draw one more 120 million euro for gas storage construction. It hasn't been prepared new legislative initiative on gas storage project. The gas storage project is temporarily suspended until the final decision of the Georgian government, including on the issue of financing. Knowing the details of the strategic project, energy expert Murman Margulashvili says that the gas storage is crucial for the independence and safety of our country. The gas storage project is very important for the independence of our country, and there is no reason for hesitating on this way. The country, which totally depends on external factors, is weak, but if we want to be independent, we should create some mechanism for it. Without the gas storage building, any side infrastructure like pipelines also loses sense. This detail is also mentioned in a long-term document, 10-year development plan for Georgian gas transmission network. Dean of Energy Faculty of Georgian Technical University, Giarabidze, says that without the storage and the subsequent infrastructure, our country can save gas, especially in summertime when consumption is low. There is no reason to say no to the gas storage project. We can save at least 3 million cubic meters, and it would be a very good result. Georgia can use this resource for electricity generation, and this way it can also reduce the import. On the other hand, we can distribute the storage to the different sectors of the economy during the winter. This is a fact. Georgia has just missed the chance to start one more strategic project. And this is happening in a reality when, on the one hand, government spend money designated to build the gas storage on relieving COVID results, and on the other hand, it refused conditioned 75 million euro tranche from European Union.
Well, that's all for now. We will meet on Sunday at 10 p.m.
Till then, you already know you have to follow us on bm.g and forbes.gm. Till Sunday then, 10 p.m. sharp.
Checkpoint is presented by GM Pharma, the first international multinational pharmaceutical company in Georgia. GM Pharma, to serve those who need it most.